Gaming Division.
Hey there, welcome to Gaming Division. I am Camerai, and it's been a little while, but we're going to do some more unboxing for Super Dungeon Explorer. I still love the game. I love the product. I want more people to play it. I want to play it more, and I want to play with all these new components all at once. Ah! So, what's happened is I've gotten the rest of the Wave 2 for Forgotten King in, and I have everything up to date. As of recording this, Beatrix and Jax come out in October next month. So I plan on getting those, but it will be next month because I'll just have to keep an eye out. The very first thing that we have on board is the Dungeons of Crystallia. For whatever reason, I thought it was the Plains, and I don't know why I didn't understand it was the Dungeons. I really thought we were going to be getting some planes, so I've got to redo some thinking there. These have staples in the bottom, which is actually pretty smart. So let me undo those, and then we will open up the bottom like we did for the Vondrak Manor tile set. So that I can preserve the box a little bit, or the packaging, rather. It's in this giant blister thing. I don't rip. This is very unfortunate. Alright. You improvise where you have to. Let's go ahead and get this product out of the case. And I was really hoping to keep this as pristine as possible. I obviously failed. Let's go ahead and slide the boards out. So yeah, so there's our empty packaging. I'm just going to roll that to the side. It's not really worth looking at that much. But it comes with our token creepers and tile effect cards. We'll come back to that in just a second because I do want to show these off. Now, there are three different models in four different colors. This beautiful, translucent plastic color. These are really, they're just cute, and I just dropped one, so I'll have to pick that up in a minute. I dropped two of them, but I especially like that blue. It's a really pretty blue that they've got going on there. They definitely put some thought into it. What I don't like is that I want to paint these things. So what I'll probably end up doing is I'll paint their eyes or something, eventually. You know, I am about painting. But I'm going to leave the rest of it alone, I think. Forsooth. I really need to replace my knife. I think it's a mandatory at this point. So, as long as we are careful... I can pretend to be a chipmunk. Meh. And then... tear. Yeah. The plastic is pretty sturdy as far as the seals go. Once you actually break the seals, the rip into that pretty easy. If you do use a knife, be sure to point the blade away from yourself. Be safe at all times. It's really sad. Like, there's not a lot of things you can do to hurt yourself by board gaming. So it's really sad when you do one of the few things that you can. So one of the cool things we're seeing right off the bat is like this alchemy symbol type thing. What this reminds me of a lot is the dungeon tiles from the Dragon Peaks set. Because the Dragon Peaks really is a combination of like three different sets. And the dungeons there, I think, really got a lot of influence from these. Or, reverse that. These got a lot of influence from those. I think it shows a little bit. And I think these actually are lifted mostly from the PvP map. Not directly, of course, but I think the PvP map was with the dungeon in mind, and then... I'm just going to leave those there like that. I think that shows up on camera fairly well. Real quick, let's look at the cards. Now, the slimes are very particular creeps. Creeps are a new thing in Forgotten King, if you're unaware. where they can actually invade the player's card. And the ability is called Invader. And essentially what these do is these stop heroes from benefiting from equipment of different affinities. Now, they added this affinity thing that they carried over to Ninja All-Stars. Hopefully that shows up. On the left side there, there's a little crystal that shows the... So essentially you can't use cards of that color. So with that, let's go ahead and jump in. I'm torn. We will do the Emerald Valley first. This is the Emerald Valley Warband. This, I think, is officially available in November. If you back the Kickstarter, it should have already gotten out to you. There are a few extenuating circumstances, and I sympathize heavily with you, other than that, where you should be able to get it. And I would have paid more to get it elsewhere earlier, I'll be honest. But, I came down to it, they did get it to me. I'm a little concerned on her thing. I'm excited again, though. Wow, I took a little bit of time after I got this. Now, the warbands are really interesting. Like, I've got the Mistmorn Coast and the Stilltown Zombies over here. Both of them came with one hero and then a very themed little warband with a mini-boss included. I'm expecting these to do the same thing. Put that there for now. And in the Emerald Warband, the hero is this little Joan of Arc character, and she actually has a standard for a weapon, which if you know anything about Joan of Arc, that was her weapon. She forewent her sword eventually and then just flew the banner of God or whatever. We'll put that right there. And the thing with the Emerald Valley, this is really strange. If you know anything about, like, Shonen anime or, Japan, like, history stuff, there's some sort of thing with, people wearing belts. Now, you'd assume belts are to hold up pants, ultimately. So, like, the theory was with Karate Masters was the longer that you train, the darker your belt became because you've been training longer, and that's how you got your black belt, by simply just having a belt that was that old for the duration of your training. But you see it a lot in different anime and whatnot, these crazy-looking belts and everything. And these are like little mushroom guys. There's a couple of these crazies. We'll go ahead and stick them out here. We'll hold on to that for a second. These are actually cute. There's little tiny ones that are, I'm assuming, just the basic foot soldiers. And they're just tiny little mushroom heads. I actually find them to be quite adorable. This game has a lot of cute artwork. The models are fairly awesome. And it looks like there's, I don't know, 8 of them? Yeah. So these have got to be little one-skull monsters, and I think they got rid of most of the three-skull monsters. We'll figure out in a minute. And then the, like, little Satriant thing that they've got here for the spawning point. They've got little tiny, tiny mushrooms, almost like snotlings. And then they come with these boars, which I wish they had made the dogs, the Emerald Hounds or the Fire Hounds or whatever, this size or smaller, because this makes sense. For a giant boar, that would, I honestly, if you've ever seen a boar, they're like twice the size of a dog. So it makes sense to me that they would be bigger. The real shining jewel of this is Glimmerwing. And I keep going back and forth. It's such a beautiful model, though. And a lot of people are painting her up very fey. Or him, or her, or whatever. I don't care. And the wings are modeled for it. They're very done up as crystalline wings instead of typical dragon wings. And they're really neat. And in my head, it's more of that it's a fey character and not a dragon character. It just has to be dragon-shaped. So, I don't know what the card actually says about her, or him, or whatever it. But if I can get it open, there we go. Doo-doo-doo. All right, and then the hero character is the Silver Chevalier. Cross 3 for 2 actions. Silver Lance is 1. Oh, but you get a pounce. Okay, that's interesting. And then she can actually re-roll a defense roll with her potion. So she's interesting. She's got a melee 2 for standard attacks, 2 blue, 1 red. 2 red on the armor, which makes quite a bit of difference. Glimmerwing at least can fly. Fairy dragon mini boss. So it is both a dragon and a fairy. Immune to Bane, immune to whatever the eyeball one is. Breath of Dream, Lance 6, slow. Magic attack. Oh, interesting. Range 6, 3 red on the will for a magic attack. Only 5 hearts or whatever. What seems to be happening on the warbands, which I don't agree with, is that we are not getting the mini boss, the Dark Hero cards. That's what we're looking at. I'd love to play Glimmerwing as a hero. I think that'd be really interesting. Fungal Growth is the spawning points. Immune to status effects, of course, Sporific Cloud. When a hero that does not have the green crystal moves within 2 squares of Fungal Growth, they suffer slow. So that's neat. Oka Shroom is the big guys. Whirling Shiitake. 3 actions for the big guys. 2 skulls. 4 health. He's like a mini boss. All blue on stats, though. So that's good. Whirling Shiitake. 1 action. Wave 3. So he can do that 3 times. Sorry, wave 1. But he can do that 3 times and hurt everybody if he just wades in there. And he's a big model, so he can hit the extra number. That's crazy. And then, yeah, the Kino Shrooms are the small ones, and they're little silly things. Bounce and bump. so they can just actually, they can literally push you around for their action instead of that. But what is... Oh, so Sporific... Sporific. It says Sporific. So they cause a lot of slow, a lot of manipulation going on here. And then Spongy, when a model with Spongy is targeted, push the model that targeted them 1 square after the action has been resolved, even if the model with Spongy was destroyed. This is very interesting. And then Truffle Pigs, of course, that's why we have boars with this. And they're 2 skulls, 2 wounds, 2 red on the strength. Wow. And they can use both their actions, they only have 2. For Tusker, which gives them an additional red, and Knockdown. Yay! But they don't have any special abilities. And then the rest of it is arcade cards. And then for Glimmerwing, you have a Shimmering Robes card for the green slot. That's what's confusing me with the crystals and the slots. Which gives you Stealth and plus 2 blue dex. And this ability called Verdant Dream. Will versus Will for a Compel. Okay. So that's interesting. Just make a little pile for the cards. So let's go ahead and open up the other one. As much as I'm excited for Glimmerwing, Which also, it doesn't make a lot of sense to me, other than, like, it's not... They didn't do it as a standard dragon or anything. Is the claws of the worm that we've got going on here. So... get this opened up. Oh, man. Okay, so... it feels good to open these up. It just does. I probably need to pick up the pace just a little bit, I think. Okay, let's get this open, and then we'll show these off a little bit. Okay, so just because it's in the way, let's start with the mini boss on this one. This guy's awesome. He's not as big as Sir Snapjaw, which bothers me a little bit, but he's got this big lance, and he's riding a dinosaur. He's riding like a mini dragon of some kind. Super awesome. Super awesome mini. God, I want to keep showing him off. That's going to look cool out on the map. And that'll be very useful elsewise. I really like the spawning point. They've moved to smaller spawning points, which I don't appreciate. I did like the larger spawning points, like the taller ones. I just wish they weren't so fat. And these seem to be short and fat. So, small issues with that, but nothing too crazy. I'm trying to figure out a way to do this. We'll just keep the heroes in the middle here, I think. We got a couple Kobold Assassins. It's really cool to see them expand on the Kobolds a little bit. I really like that. We've got a couple Kobold, like, Taskmaster types of the whips. We're going to go ahead and move them back a little bit. This concerns me that I have an extra base, because that makes me feel like, oh, okay, it belongs to this young Drakeling. And I've got some model glue. I can fix that. It's not a problem. I'm not even complaining about that. But it comes with, like, quite a few of these. One, two, looks like six of them. And three Taskmasters. So it probably pairs... two Drakelings to a Taskmaster. Stop being a pain in the butt. But I like that there's so many different dragon models out there now for this game. Because it really helps vary it up, and it helps me out with, like, kind of theming dungeons, which I really like. Oh, real quick, too. I do not like his big flourish on his cape. I was okay with her hair because it was more flush against her back, but this is taking up a whole couple more squares. So if I can, I will probably heat this up and remold it somehow. But this is the Dragon Blade. I'm sorry. In my head, he's the dragon. He's got a cool helmet and everything. I'm trying to show them off as best I can here. The model works amazing. Like, it's really neat that they had such a creative idea with it, and then they took it in the route that they did, and then they had such a boppo game to put behind it. And I know nobody says boppo, but I'm saying it. So, put that back. Oh, man. Where's my framing at for this? Okay. So real quick, we'll go through the cards. Do not be sealed so that I have to cut you. That's just... I was all happy that they were doing things right. And okay, I see what they did. This is done with a different model where you actually have holes in the front of things. Ugh. Sorry, I know that was random. things you do stay the same. Okay, so one of the things I like about just immediately is that he's another one that brings out the green die. For two actions out of your three, you can use Head Chopper, which gives you a green die plus your strength. He's immune to fire. He has something called Dragon Spite, which means may reroll a single die when making offensive actions against dragon, drake, or kobold models. So essentially, he's got Holy for dragons. This is interesting. Sure, Sharp Claw is actually our Wormclaw Templar rider, and I'm glad I opened this up second because it makes me look stupid. There is a hero card in here for the Wormclaw Templar, the guy on our little Drake riding thing here, which is pretty cool. And it's reach of three, so he can hit three away from himself. Two actions for Onslaught Lance, three push three. Two actions for Chomp Crunch. Range three, plus one red strength, Bane. And then he's got a potion, Dragon Dung Confetti. Jeez. Wave one, Hex, that's what that one is. And then the Dragon Blade, he still had other actions. Three actions for Dragon Slayer. Dragon Slayer inflicts a wound, instead inflicts one wound for every star. The offense roll exceeds the defense roll. For an armored up knight, he is all about dealing out the damage. Wow. And then his potion is actually an offensive potion. Bottled Bat Dragon Breath. Looks like poison? No, that's dangerous. I'm sorry. Dangerous melee sweep 2 of strength. Okay. Sweep 2 fire. So essentially he's uses his strength to actually spit fire at the enemies. That's pretty cool. And then... oh, the bad guy's abilities are the same. The stats just change a little bit for Wormclaw Templar. And he's Savage. So what's Savage? All minions within one square of a model with Savage gain plus one strength. So he's a moving champion statue on the new boards. And movement 8, by the way, for that dragon steed. So the little spawn points are called Claw Shrines. Dragon, Drakes, and Kobolds within two squares of Claw Shrine gain plus one strength. So adding that with mobs is actually pretty good. The Black Claw Assassins that we saw, Mob, Stealth, Backstabber, use both their actions to assassinate. They have no armor, though. Plus one red strength, the Black Claw Assassin's bonus from Mob is plus three blue. Black Claw Assassin gains massive damage. Ouch! So that's cool. Backstabber model. Backstabber suffers a wound. They may place the wound token on an adjacent friendly model instead. So that's a dirty thing. So Claw Trainer is the guy with the whip, obviously. So he has some things. Art of Three, all Drakes gain mob, which is actually pretty nasty compared with, or combined with some of the other Drakelings and stuff. And Monster Tamer, range 6, target minion may immediately make one basic action. Oh, so he can actually dole out his action. Drakehound, Blood Scent, plus 1 strength, addition to 3 blue. Target model is suffering 1, if target model is suffering 1 or more wounds. And then Knockdown and Pylon. Model with Pylon gains plus 1 blue if the target is suffering knockdown. Okay. And then arcade cards, and then Drake Kebab is the Wormclaw Templar's special item. It's plus one blue strength on the yellow slot, and an ability called Snakebite Skewer. Lance 8 Hex. Wow. Shut off this camera too, just in case. So we are certainly stacking up on cards here. So fortunately, those are the warbands. Well, I've got a couple big boxes I'm gonna reveal. Just a second, trying to make sure that this... maybe I can show it off and talk about it at the same time. That would be ideal, but... oh, there we go. Okay, so the Deep Root Wolf Rider. Oh, for the record, the Dragon Blade is actually an Elvish character, even though he's all armored up like that, which I think is very interesting that they deviated from typical woodsy elves. So the Deep Root Rider is a special hero that they... it was one of the Kickstarter stretch goals, and they were putting out. He's actually a mounted archer. So unlike our Wormclaw Templar, he's not a melee character, but he's a ranged character of the same, not the same fashion, but a similar fashion. He's on this big doggy. So that's going to be fun. We've got to bump him back a little bit. I know I may just push back the bad guys there. He's got a cool little pose. He looks a little weedy because he's all super chitty, but there we go. Put that over there. We'll put this back. How does that look on camera? Sure, why not? Okay, and I'm just going to leave this sleeve because it's the only card in the box. Deep Root Wolf Rider. Movement 8 seems to be standard for cavalry. 2 blue, 1 red strength. Range 4, 3 blue on the deck. So he's more even than I thought he was going to be. 2 actions for harass. Range 4, slow and knockdown. Wolf Spirit, melee, plus 1 strength, and pounce. So it's not really range 1 if it's pounce, because pounce is 5 squares away, so you essentially jump to him. Surefoot, model with Surefoot treats difficult terrain. Squares is open squares. All non-blessing tile effects in those squares are ignored. And then his potion is Glimmerberry Juice. Range 6, drink immediately after an offensive roll is made. Target enemy model must reroll all dice from their last offensive roll. So that's the second one that lets us do kind of a reroll type thing. I'm not sure how I feel about rerolls. But I've played enough Blood Bowl to know that it can be worth it. I'm really excited about this guy. He's an actual big boss. For those of you who don't know, next month, Beatrix the Witch and Jack the Scarecrow are coming out. Jack the Scarecrow is a hero, in theory. And Beatrix is another boss. It's probably going to come out in a box like this. But I was excited for him. Oh, come on. Let me use your horn. Because in my head, he's like a fairy mob boss. And his little description's not there. But, so that's, in my head, that's totally where he's at. And he actually comes with multiple models. He comes with these little, they're called Geary. And they're like tiny versions of him. And he's a bit, essentially like a big ground squirrel with a horn on his head. And they're just little ones. And they're holding like, celery stalks, like, Farfetch. So we're just, I'm going to put him here. And we're going to put these down. They just move the boxes out of the way. That may be the better way to go. But you'll see, too, that and the Mistborn Coast guys are like this, too. But they kind of match the Emerald Valley, which helps lean me towards the Fae stuff, because that seems to be where it's happening. So we'll just put that there. And, of course, they come with their cards. I want to read the Geary cards. And I don't know why. If you ever make a game, do not fucking make tiny cards. I hate it with a passion. So I'll add that to the exploration cards. Boss spawn, Wind Spirit, all elite and minion monsters gain the ability Fly, which is nice from a non-flying creature. Timeout Girl, Geary Swarm, spawn 6 Geary within 2 squares of Goro. So it's good to know that that's going on there. And then that's got the hole in the back, so we'll go ahead and do that real quick so that I can read the creep cards to you at least. And I'm excited to see what Goro himself does, but I think I'm more excited aesthetically and thematically. Then mechanically, and he was on the front, so I could have just started reading. Alright, real quick, there's treasure that comes with him as well. That's a lot of treasure. So the Geary, the way they work, insignificant mob, their celery stalks give them a range of 2 blue dice, though. New crop, place 1 skull point of Kinoko or Kadama from anywhere in the dungeon adjacent to Giri. Kinoko or Kadama? Is that the mushrooms? It's gotta be. Leaks, that's what they're called. So there's a bunch of treasure cards, there's a leak, there's a totem mask. I don't know. Like, I want to get excited about these, but I feel like the heroes already have so much going on for them as it is. I forgot to put this away. So, let's do that. I've got a couple more things. I know this has probably run long already. Let's go ahead and put that there. But I've got five little single shot hero things to do real quick. So let's go ahead and get through that. And of course, they're all sealed up top. I love these little boxes. They look great. They store great. Just not always the most convenient thing ever. So the first one I'm opening up is the Wandering Minstrel. This is another little elvish character so he's like the third one. Yeah. And he's this cool little bard. He's got a lute on his back. He's got a sword in front of his face that's all bent. So that's what he's looking like there. We'll go ahead and pop the wolf back since he's so big. And tell you what, we'll rotate these around as well because we're going to need some space here. So movement 7, which is fast, of course. He's got a wave 2 slow ability. He's got a R2 plus 1 in all offense rolls, which is actually nice. That's his jaunty tune. His potion ability is a wave 3 knockdown, powdered power cord, and faint. When a model with faint makes an offensive action, they may choose one dice from their target's defense roll and force them to re-roll the result, which is interesting. He's one red, one blue on melee, two red on dex. So if you can give him dexty stuff, that's great, but he doesn't come with a natural dex card. But he does have dodge. Or he can use his dex as a defense for the newer terms. I really hope they keep the terminology around for that, though. Okay, so the next one's going to be a little weird, but I figured out of everything is probably the one that actually makes the most sense to do next. Kanochi Candy! So she's a ninja, but she's a mystic ninja, so that makes her, in the Super Dungeon world, a magic user, apparently. I played with her a little bit, but she comes with a ninja tanuki character for Cola, and he's got a big old shuriken in there, which I thought was really cute and funny. But they very much make her a Kanochi. I know I'm probably... No, that's the right word. Kanochi Kitsume is what I think I meant. But they kind of like... I don't know, they got her chest exposed. The idea is that she's supposed to be this cute ninja girl, and I guess that's what you do with that. But the point is that she is range 6 magic with 2 will, and then she uses her dex for 2 red dex for defense. You would think I would have gotten scissors. And the Ninja Cola is the pet character. Now, what I don't see... Oh, okay. So, yeah, so her potion is Ninja Pop. Models affected by Ninja Pop gain fly and may move through walls. So it's like a blink ability. Distracting costume, 2 actions, wave 1, hex. Now, my concern there... Oh! You can actually use Ninja Cola and Kanochi Candy as a mini-boss. That's an interesting way to go with it. Suit Kimono for plus two movement. The Whirling Dune, which is Ninja Cola's thing that he's holding. Plus one red if you're green. You have green affinity, it's plus one green. And Ninja Cola actually has some cool abilities. He's got a hook shot, which is for one of his things. He's got three actions. He's a normal character. Kitsune Hiro. Wow. He's an actual character. He's not even a pet. That's ridiculous all on its own. But super excited about it. That changes things a little bit. Not too much. Not for the big adventure. Now, the next one is Brave Mode Candy. She also comes with a little Tanuki buddy. And this one is Never Lost Cola. And if I'm correct, this one is a pet. And I'll show you why the order of this makes sense. Just a minute. So, yeah, so this one, Cola's got like a big clock, or I think it's either supposed to be a compass or a clock. It's really hard to see there. But I really like the free-spirited warrior mode. I don't like how they did the hilt of that sword against her head, but you do what you can. But I really like the free spirit of the model. I think it really models Candy well. Being both brave and joyful. Not that I'm an expert on Candy, but that's kind of how I feel about her. So I really think that they did a good job with this model. So bump that back. Okay. Oh, cards. So yeah, so Never Lost Cola is a pet. And I have to find out if you start with it automatically, because most of the pets are just supposed to be treasure that you find, which I think is silly, but the pair's got enough equipment as it is, so I can't really complain that, like, we're going to muddle up that deck that much. Okay, so we do have the pet card for Never Lost Cola. Brave Master, Brave Mode Candy, Alchemy Pet. So, when a model with Alchemy rolls a heart, they may choose to gain a potion instead, so that's neat. Pet, Never Lost Cola, so she does start the game with him. And then I'm looking at another card that I wasn't expecting, which is interesting. What is Never Lost Cola's ability? When drawing explore cards, the party may draw two and choose one. So that's good. Brave Mode Candy is strength, two red, three blue armor. Soda Detector, plus two red, wow, for two actions. Sugar Dervish, I don't know why that made me laugh. Wave one, two actions for melee, which is pretty nifty. Then she has two potions, Soothing Soda, which heals status effects, and then the Wave 1 Poison, which that's pretty nasty on its own. And she can hold two potions. The original candy can hold three, but I'm looking at a new version, because I didn't know about this at all. Still two blue strength. She still has Cola with her as not a individual pet. She's got her affinity. I guess they had to do it some way. I didn't realize I didn't have a card for her. I guess this is one way to find out. But now she has magic. Two red on the will. Sweet. She still has vending machine. Remove a single potion token from Candy's card and place it on target hero's card within six. Potion, soothing soda, heal status effects. Three, if you use all three potions, you can use Sugar Rush for two more actions. And then she's got luck as well. So I can do the lucky party again, and they may actually have a chance. That was a super exciting surprise. I don't know how I didn't realize that I didn't have a new card for Candy. You would think with a special edition model like Candy and Cola, they would make a point of that. Maybe I just missed the announcement. It happens. There's a lot of things that go on. So what I open now is Shadow Mode Candy, which is the bad guy version of Brave Mode Candy, which to me makes a lot of sense that I would open up her afterwards. So this is essentially a Demonkin Nether Shadow mini-boss, which means anything Nether in this game says Demon. I don't like that the sword's cut off where it is, but I'm just going to pretend she uses a flat sword, and I'll be happy. And it's got that cool pink. I actually really like this pink for models. There's really not much going on in the back. I really wish that sword is flush, but until I can fix that on my own, I'll be fine. She's got some kind of treasure behind her. But, 4 blue on the strength, 2 red on the dex, but she doesn't have dodge. She uses her armor for defense. I've got to see what this Dark Radiance ability is. So bear with me. We are almost through. We got one more. I should not be throwing things at the microphone. Due diligence. I don't know why I'm singing. Okay, so that's her arcade card. Dark Radiance. All offense rolls and defense rolls made against a model with Dark Radiance reduce the result by 1 star. Wow. Ice. The model suffering ice may not use unique actions. Unique actions. So she's got an ability called Dark Howling, which is range 6, burst 2. And that uses the dex because it has that arrow symbol. So that's what you want to use. And then she's got one more hit to clean up. 4 blue. Wow. Nether Soul. Plus 1 blue strength. Nether Soul. Excuse me. Inflicts a wound. Shadow Mode Candy may use any hearts rolled to heal. So she's got a temporal blood drinker or whatever. Shadow. Place Shadow Mode Candy against adjacent to any monster. What? So she can blink around the map, too? That's crazy. So that's you Dark Howling with her, and then you blink away. That's crazy. And then her... Oh, it's a one-shot equipment. This is interesting. Dark Reflection. One use only. Range 6. Until its next upkeep, this model may use the target model's attributes for any roll it must make, including any bonuses either model possesses. That's interesting. She's kind of neat. I wasn't expecting her to be so complex. The last one, which is what I thought was the more limited edition, but I think she's just another special character. I don't think she's actually limited edition, is the Twilight Knight. Now, she is another crossover character. Like Marie Claude was actually based off a real person slash cosplayer or whatever you want to call her. This is based off a pinup group or something. So if you actually look up Twilight Knight, you'll see a lot of, like, really sexily clad things. And you're like, how are they cosplaying this already? And it's not. It's the model. The art is reflecting real life. And we've got another instance of a cape that I don't like. So I think... And her sword's all bent back. So I think I'll do the hot water trick, and I'll see what I can do to get the cape to behave, or the capes, and this sword. But she's actually a really cool-looking model. If you pretend she's not just wearing straps, I think you really can get a lot out of her. I really think she's good. Now, if I remember right, as a character, she's a little odd. 1 blue, 1 red, uses 2 blue armor or 3 blue dex for defense. Piercing Blade, Lance 2, 1 action, so you can do that 3 times, which is nice. But she's got this ability called Gloom Shatter, which I think is supposed to be her bread and butter. Dangerous, Aura 2, reduce all offense rolls made in the area by 1 star. Twilight Knight is not affected by Gloom Shatter. And then Lamplight, Wave 5, destroy all traps and creeps. So, that's neat. And she's got the Faint ability, so she's kind of like the Bard. She's just different. I don't know how to use her immediately when I look at her character. I really don't. But real quick, I probably could have used this space back here a little better. But this is all the stuff we unboxed. I know it's a lot. Thank you for sitting by and watching me unbox things for this wonderful, wonderful little game that I feel the need to waste money on to the nth degree. But I own it. So I feel like I can do a couple things with it, and I honestly plan on doing it. I really enjoy this game. I look forward to incorporating some of these new items and toys into the mix here. But, hell, I'm Camurai. Till you see me next time, have a nice day, and that's game over.
If you want to see anything else we're up to, go ahead and click the annotations, and they'll take you to our other channels.